meeting of March 6th. Will you stand for Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Allen?
Here.
Broughton?
Here.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Here.
Cordella?
Here.
Marshall?
Here.
Thurman?
Here. At this time, we need to approve our agenda. I just have a couple adjustments. I believe Dr. Outlaw, well, Kevin's here, so. Okay, I'd like to move the police liaison contract up on our agenda. If we could move that under, between D and E, so we can, actually, we could even swap it with E and move the D to H.
In the same section?
Yes, in the same section.
Okay.
Under new business. So H will be E and E will be H. How's that?
Okay.
All righty, and also under items B and C, can you just make a notation that it's going to be resolutions with a S on both of them, because there's two resolutions that we need to look at for each one. Does anybody else have any adjustments to our agenda before we get started?
No.
Would someone like to make a motion to approve the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Would someone like to second?
Support.
Oh, let's get to it.
I'm in a rush.
I was gonna let Scott do it, you know, the first
time. Oh, I gave a second.
You gotta be quick.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, say nay. The agenda has been approved as amended. So we're going to start our meeting tonight with two public hearings. One's gonna be on the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant, and the other ones could be on the Michigan National Resource Trust Fund grant. So we'll open the public hearing, ask for those of you that would like to speak to each one to step up, and then we'll close that hearing, open up the second one, and then ask again. So if everyone's on board, who would like to make a motion to open the public hearing for the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. All right. I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Broughton, to open the public hearing for the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant. I know with closed session I have to take a roll call, but I'll do a roll call just in case.
It's better.
So roll call, please.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. So at this time, we will take public comments on the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant. So if there's anyone that would like to step up to the podium, this is a grant for parking, volleyball, area in the new park, and also basketball with trails and bioswales.
Yeah, as Fred Weybrand is a recreation director of Charter Township of Brandon, oversee the township park and programs that are held down here at Sherman Village Park. And this grant that we're writing is a continuation of the grant we just received, which was to build four baseball fields, 100 spaces for accessible parking, benches, everything's universal accessible designed. We did get a letter from Cindy Burkhauer, who's executive director of Access to Recreation. She visited the park, and she's very pleased on what's taking place as far as the universal accessible design goes. And for this grant, it's like I said, it's a continuation of the grant we just received. And I talked to DNR, they're okay with supporting that kind of grant writing. And it's for, as Supervisor Thurman stated, 100 additional spaces for universal accessible designed parking, which is where we have parking in groupings with concrete landings. It has the universal or the accessible benches and picnic tables for wheelchair or some kind of disability accessibility. It also has the 4 sand volleyball courts, which are is probably the only non-accessible item on it. And then we have an accessible basketball court with linking pathways, pedestrians crossings, bioswales for drainage, which is part of the environmental point system that they asked for. So where I'm hoping that we hear some big input on this and we move forward with it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, would anyone else like to speak in regard to the Land and Water Conservation Fund?
Excuse me. Yes, Bob MacArthur at 445 Schoolhouse Street. On behalf of my own family, who from my grandkids up to my kids have participated in all the sports involved with Brandon Recreation, but also with the Brandon Groveland Youth Assistance, which I am chairman of, we supported the provided letters of recommendation for the ball fields into those grants and also into this grant. It's extremely important from, at least from our perspective of the community and for what's important for these kids is to have good recreation facilities, places to go, and to add to our community, because we know that we keep these kids busy with good activities. It's good, healthy stuff mentally and physically, and we definitely support this program and look forward to hopefully we get those grants, because then we know that this will move forward. And I think using this cell tower money is way overdue for recreation and using these funds to support that. Thank you.
Hey, thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to speak in regard to the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant? I would like to speak as a resident, Courtney, in support of the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant. I believe that this is a great thing for the community. It should provide additional recreation opportunities, so it's well worth it.
If I may, just for a matter of bookkeeping.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
There was a copy of this placed on the desk when we arrived,
yes.
And I see no difference between that and the one that was in our file. Is where the difference
okay.
is at?
If you look at the copy that you
this
got
is the one
on
that was
the
left.
Desk,
okay.
In the top paragraph, it says Landon. It says Natural Trust Fund Grant.
Yes. Ah, okay, I see.
So that's where the difference is going to be. Plus,
okay.
on the other one, you'll see that the figures are have been changed.
You're right, I found that one. But
okay.
I guess my re-comprehension needs to be. You know,
no, that's so. Fine.
It wasn't highlighted.
Yeah.
in your defense.
Thank you.
No problem. We would have gone through that later in the agenda, but I should have mentioned something prior to the meeting. Because it is a little bit confusing. Okay, are there any other comments in regard to the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant?
Okay. I'll also go on record as supporting it.
Okay.
It is long overdue, and it's really good to see that we're going to have ball diamonds and that property all developed. I think a lot of people are going to use that park, so it's a good thing.
Yes.
Like to speak on that also. I also drafted a letter for Fred for that grant. As a current varsity baseball coach and a 14U travel coach for a team called the Brandon Hawks, those fields have been needed for years. I mean, we're in a situation this year of not having enough space to run 14U and older to where it pushes the seasons back later. We've continually lost kids from the rec program here to Oxford, to Independence Township, And unfortunately, because of some of those programs, some of those kids don't come back. They end up going to school there in Oxford because of their baseball programs and people that they meet through those baseball programs. These fields, I played on those fields when I was a young kid, and those fields are not much different than what they were when I played on them. And, you know, baseball has kind of been a little bit of a dying sport lately, and we need those fields to hold tournaments and those type of things to help support the travel teams in this area. So I would push for support on that as well.
Okay, yes, sir.
Kevin McClellan, 1845 North Hadley. I would support exactly what you just said. When you talk about the loss and you go over and see some of the things that are going on in Clarkston and on the weekends with their baseball fields, those places are packed. So I do agree. We've needed something like that for a long time, and I'm in support of that as well.
And just to clarify, the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant is not for baseball fields. We received approval for the baseball field part of it, but it's additional parking to support the fields plus volleyball and basketball courts.
Understood. Thanks.
All right, thank you. Did anyone else want to make a comment? Okay. All right, at this time, we need to close our public hearing for the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant. Who would like to make the motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
All
support.
Right. Okay, I have a motion by Trustee DePalma, supported by Trustee Marshall, to close the public hearing for the Land and Water Conservation Fund grant. And if there's no discussion, roll call, please.
Marshall.
Yes.
Allen.
Yes.
Broughton.
Yes.
Darnall is absent with notice. DePalma. Cordella.
Yes.
Thurman.
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. So at this time, we need to open the public hearing for the Michigan Natural Resource Trust Fund grant. And just to let everyone know, it's the exact same grant we're applying from two different funding sources. So at did you want to say something before we open the public hearing, or did you want to say something
for the public hearing?
For the public hearing. Okay, so at this time we need to open the public hearing for the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund grant. Wait, so we need
so moved.
Thank okay. you.
Support.
All right, I have a motion by Clerk Allen, supported by Trustee Marshall, to open the public hearing for the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund grant. Let's do a roll call, please.
Allen.
Yes.
Broughton.
Yes.
Darnall is absent with notice. DePalma.
Yes.
Cordella.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Thurman.
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. Okay, now you can go.
Okay, as the director, Fredway Brent. The Michigan Natural Resource Trust Fund grant is once again a continuation of the Land and Water Conservation grant we just received. So, and the continuation part of it is to extend the parking lot down the ball fields, additional 100 accessible or universal accessible designed parking lot, the four volleyball courts, the basketball court, which is also accessible, benching. One thing we didn't mention last time is signage, assorted signage, which is also accessible. When we use the term accessible, we try to fit in to things that are set at designed for it's wheelchair accessible that way. So when your signage is installed, it's actually a little lower than what you normally would see. And then the pathways are also 6 to 8 foot wide. And it's an aggregate or concrete. All the parking's concrete. All the bench landings are concrete. Picnic tables are concrete. Bleacher areas, well, that's in the past grant, is concrete. So those kind of things are accessible. And we are also applying for that grant. Hopefully we'll get one or the other. Thank you.
And Fred, when you're saying they're concrete, you're meaning the concrete base, right? Not the structure themselves.
Concrete base.
Okay, thank you.
Does that include the parking spaces?
Yes.
Parking spaces concrete?
Just the accessible spaces.
Yeah, just the accessible spaces. They're
not the entire parking.
Yeah, because the van accessible, so when they slide the door open, you'd be able to get out on something hard.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
If I might ask, are these two grants exclusive of each other? If we get one, we can't get the other. Is that it?
You know.
Okay.
Okay. At this time, what we're doing a public hearing, so we're just hearing from the public. When we get to the grants, then we can ask all kinds of questions about them.
I've been scolded.
That's okay. But if you would like to speak in support of the grant or against the grant, now's a good time.
No, I just had a question about the grant, and I was already given the answer after, you know, right before I was scolded.
All right. Is there anyone that would like to speak in regard to the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund grant? I will go ahead and make a comment on the record that I also support this grant for the same reasons as I supported the land and water grant.
I'll also agree with that entirely. I support this grant and support all the good things it'll do for the township, like many of you have already spoken about. So Definitely in favor of it.
All right, thank you. Is there anyone out there that would like to speak to the Natural Resource Trust Fund grant so that we can include the public support on our application?
Well, if it requires public support, then I'll support it.
Ditto.
Okay. Kathy, I will again, and I'll piggyback off something that Bob MacArthur talked about. Any time that we have a place for the kids to get out, exercise, partake in things other than things that are going to get them in trouble, it's always a good thing. You know, when we go by the ball fields here in town and the basketball courts are packed, that gives those kids something to do. And if they don't have something to do, they're running the streets, and that's when they start getting in trouble. So, you know, whether it's baseball fields, volleyball courts, whatever it is, that we would fully support it because it does give those kids another avenue.
Good. All right. Thank you.
I guess I want to make sure that the Brandon Groveland Youth Assistance is recognized with supporting that again.
Okay.
And again with Greg's comment about playing ball on that on the two fields there, I played ball, but there was only one field there when I.
All right. Thank you for the comment. Is there anyone else that would like to make a comment on the Michigan Natural Resource Trust Fund grant? Okay. All right, so we need a board member to make a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Broughton to close the public hearing for the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund grant. And roll call, please.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. Okay, we got that little bit of business done. We can move on to our reports. Thank you, everybody, for being here tonight. First is our treasury report that's in our packet. Then we have our reconciliation report and our general ledger with our designated report. We also have a building department report, and I just wanted to state that home building is up this year. We have 11 new housing starts by the end of February, and last year at this time we had 6. So We're up by five. We also have a recreation report, and our recreation director is here. Did you want to add to your report?
Really, the only thing I have to say, other than answer any questions, is our ski club just wrapped up the program last Friday, believe it or not. We managed to get five sessions in, one cancellation that was a makeup last Friday. We had 54 students compared to about 32 last year, which was good.
I'm sorry, did you say skate or skeet?
Ski.
Ski, okay, all right.
Yeah. And why I'm surprised that we got through this season is because we're down 4.5 inches of snow compared to last year, and as you well know, the way the weather's been, we got most of that snow in one big burst, and then we had the warm weather, so Mount Holly really struggled this year as far as Mother Nature snow went, so they were constantly making it, and we got by. If there's any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer anything.
Okay, thank you. All right. For reports, we also have our Edna Burton Senior Center report, our CDGB report, and that brings us to trustees' reports. So we'll start down with Chris. Anything to report tonight on the Planning Commission or anything?
No, we just had a very successful meeting. It looks like O'Reilly's parts store that has been ongoing, I guess, for a long time. Looks like they finally got approval from MDOT to put in the left-hand turn lane, and they're going to proceed. And so we're going to have a new auto parts store.
Chris, is that north of the Dollar General? Is that where that's going?
Right.
Would that left-hand turn lane also be in front of Dollar General as well?
They're going to share the drive.
Yeah,
from what I understand.
Because they're going to share the entrance way there.
Okay.
You know.
I just know you can't pull left out of Dollar General. Basically,
yeah.
You have to turn right. So there will be a new way to get out of there then. I mean, you can legally
no,
do
I don't,
it. It's just
I don't
very
think it'll be new. It'll be enhanced.
It will be that drive will be enhanced to Dollar General. And then I think like once you turn into the Dollar General to the left will be like a little drive to O'Reilly. That's what I understood.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not part of the Planning Commission, but that was my understanding.
Correct.
So it will help the Dollar General.
Okay. All set?
Yep.
All right. Bob.
First off, I'd like to welcome our new trustee, Scott Broughton. It'll be a pleasure working with you. Appreciate you being here. Secondly, Kathy was already up to speed on the fire board. We had a fire board meeting on the 9th, and so I was sort of brought up to speed on that with the fire board. And I guess everything runs smoothly. Chief's doing a good job and he seems to have everything in order as far as future developments with the department, which is nice to see. I tried to stump him and I couldn't.
He needs to be kept on his toes. That's good. Okay, thank you. Dana.
Yes, I was going to welcome Scott to the board too. Look forward to working with you. And then my committee is the Retirement Oversight Committee, and our meeting is tomorrow, so I don't have anything to report on it yet, but I will next month. So thank you, and welcome everybody here tonight.
All right, thank you. And Scott.
I don't have much yet, except thanks to all the board. Hopefully I will make a positive difference for everyone here and in the township.
All right, thank you, Scott. And that brings us to the treasurer report, which I believe the clerk is going to give us.
I'm going to read it. She just gave it to me at the end of the day. As of March 1st, our office can no longer accept tax payments as we are in the process of balancing to the state of Michigan. During the month of March, if you owe 2016 taxes, please get a revised statement from the treasurer's office. The check is made out to Oakland County. The revised statement needs to accompany the payment. This is Terry. I was able to attend the MMRMA conference in Lansing last Thursday. Some of the classes I attended were on the economic future of townships, leadership, financial stress in communities, and legal trends and updates. I found them to be very informative.
Thank you.
And she says, Welcome, Scott.
Thank you, Terry.
All right, that brings us to the clerk's report.
I'd like to welcome Scott Broughton as well, and I am looking forward to having our board move forward and gear up for spring of 2017. And to everybody, thank you for coming, and happy St. Patrick's Day. Brandon Groveland Youth Assistance Annual Breakfast is on Thursday, March 9th from 8 to 9 approximately. And our chairperson's here. You'll probably speak on it later. Okay. The Teens and Seniors Rocking and Raking Committee is meeting this Thursday. We lost one member from our committee last year, but has been replaced. So I'm looking forward to meeting everybody Thursday, and we'll set the date and move forward. It will either be the end of April, first part of May for the Rocking and Raking. The Brandon Township Cemetery Maintenance Contract expired in 2016, and an RFP was placed into the newspaper, and I've already had people picking up the bid packet. So the deadline to submit a sealed bid is March 28th at 3:30 with the bid opening at 4 o'clock. And it will be for a two-year term. And that's it for me.
All right, thank you. Yep. Okay, the first thing on the supervisor's report tonight is to welcome Scott to the board.
Thank you.
You're getting lots of welcomes. The Board of Review is scheduled for March 15th from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. and March 16th from 1 p.m. to 8 p.m. So if there are any residents out there that would like to appeal their assessed values that they just received in the mail, please call the supervisor's office and schedule an appointment. The phone number is 248-627-4918. And next, I wanted to remind the board that the assessor has given us her resignation, and she will no longer be with us at the end of the month. We have been advertising for her position, and if all goes well, we will probably be bringing a candidate to the April meeting for approval. The fire chief, the treasurer, and I attended the MMRMA workshop, and I took pretty much the same classes that were already mentioned and also found them to be beneficial. On Saturday, I attended a NIMS training in Lake Orion, and that is for emergency management. I found that to be beneficial as well, and the board will be seeing a budget amendment request as a result from it. We need to have some funding in our budget for emergency situations that we don't currently have, so we'll bring that to the board at our next meeting. And I wanted to also state that with Trustee Broughton's help, we are now scanning our new business and putting it on the township website. So that should be up there for residents to preview prior to the meeting. So Scott's taking this on. He's coming in on Fridays and going through his new business in his packet, making sure it's all in order, and running it through the scanner, and then we're loading it onto the website. So thank you for doing that, Scott. And we are going to replace half of our fluorescent lighting in the township office building with LED lighting, and we're working through the DTE Energy Efficiency Program for Business project. And I just found out that they will be reimbursing us for the cost of all of the LED lights that we ordered, plus a little extra to pay for part of the installation.
Nice.
Okay. So Wednesday, well, let's start with April 16th through the 22nd. That is being declared by Oakland County as Severe Weather Awareness Week. They do this every year. And on Wednesday, April 19th at 1 p.m., they will be testing all of the sirens. So usually they test the sirens the first Saturday of the month at 1 o'clock. But
it was good to hear them in March, just this last Saturday. Spring's coming.
Spring is coming, yeah, when they hear the sirens. So on April 19th, 1 p.m. That's when they're going to be testing. And I also got a notification from Andy Meisner's office, and since Terry's not here to let everyone know, residents that need financial counseling can contact the county. They are running a financial empowerment center, and it is free counseling, and it's confidential. So if there's any residents that are struggling financially, you can call the county. The number is 248-858-0624. And again, that's a free service. So that completes the supervisor's report. Now we can get into the rest of the agenda. So next is correspondence. In correspondence, we have Zoning Board of Appeals meeting minutes of September 28th, 2016. We have a BGYA invitation, and I'm sure everyone on the BGYA board would love to see all of the trustees attend the breakfast. And then we also have the Michigan Freeway Lighting Partners communication. So that brings us to citizens' comments.
I have a question. Is there bacon?
Sausage.
Sausage, no bacon? Sorry.
Okay. So at this time, we will take public comment on agenda items. And the once recognized, anyone wishing to speak shall step up to the podium and state their name. Remarks will be addressed to the chairperson in a courteous tone, and speakers will be limited to 3 minutes per comment. The board will not be responding to the public during this time. So we're going to wait till the end of the meeting, and if we have anything to say or announce, we'll do it then. So is there anyone here that would like to make a comment on agenda items? And you know, Bob's waiting here.
I haven't spoke to a township board like this in such a long time. Just a couple things. The CDBG funds, we did receive for Brandon Groveland Youth Assistance the 2016 funds from the township, and I just wanted to thank the board, and a special thanks to the township clerk, Candy Allen. You have no idea, I don't think, unless you've been involved with CDBG or community development grant money, the work that it takes to accomplish this. And we put the money to really good use to help kids with scholarships for camp and for sports that they may not have been able to attend financially. So we put that money to good use. And thanks, Candy, for the work. And then you got the invitation. And our breakfast is highlighted by child abuse prevention and autism awareness, the month of April. And that's the highlight of the breakfast. And we'll have speakers to speak briefly on those items. And again, it's a good time to meet up other community folks, organizations that'll be there. It's a good opportunity to visit with some other folks. And the last item on the agenda, I wasn't aware of, but with the police liaison, and again, from the Brandon Groveland Youth Assistance perspective of that, I don't understand what the funding or what the question is on it, but all I can tell you is that how important and how much it is used by our caseworker, the deputy that's assigned to that school, attends our meetings and provides us with input of issues that we may be able to help with, and vice versa with us to give whatever support we can to that portion of it with the caseworker side of it, which we do the prevention. We have nothing to do per se with the issues after students or kids have gotten into some issue, but our side of it is totally the prevention aspect of it. But we're involved with that officer and the caseworker that's assigned from Oakland County Circuit Court, and I would certainly hope whatever the issue is with that police officer liaison that it gets approved. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to make a comment on an agenda item? Yes.
I'm glad to see we're going forward with, I'm Roger Ingles, Township President. I would like to say I'm very happy to see we're going forward looking for the grants for the park. And I'd like to see us try to get that approved tonight and make things really, really a better thing for us. If there's anything we need is finishing out that park, and I think we have a great place. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to make a public comment on an agenda item? Everyone's being quiet. All right, we'll move on. We have no discussion this evening. We do have a consent agenda to approve. On the consent agenda are the regular meeting minutes of February 6, 2017, the supervisors' appointments to the Road Improvement Committee, regular bills in the amount of $18,180.93, prepays in the amount of $342,523.21, township benefits from payroll account of $31,540.74, and trustee timesheets in the amount of $291. Is there any discussion on the consent agenda this evening? Would someone like to make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented?
So moved.
Thank you.
Support.
I have a motion by Trustee Marshall, seconded by Clerk Allen, to approve the consent agenda as presented. And if there's no further discussion, or if there's not any discussion, which is, appears not to be, roll call, please.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. So first we have one item of unfinished business to do before we get to our new business. And that is appointment to the Board of Review. I brought this to the board at our last meeting. I'm bringing it back. We need to appoint someone right away. Board of Review, like I stated earlier, starts next week, and their first meeting is tomorrow. So I am asking that the board approve the appointment of Christine Zane to the Board of Review, and that would begin March 7th, 2017, and end December 31st, 2018. Are there any questions or concerns, comments?
I have a question.
Sure.
Were all the people you have listed on here interviewed? Were they brought in? How did you pick Christine, I guess?
Well, first, I looked at qualifications, and as I brought to the board last time, I felt Roger Ingles was the most qualified, and he was willing, but the board did not approve that appointment. So I looked at the other qualifications, let's see, and I wrote down here for you that Scott cannot serve on the Board of Review due to his appointment to the Township Board, and Heath has let me know that sometimes it's necessary for him to be called out to work on spur of the moment, like one day's notice, so that's probably not a good thing if you've got a whole day's worth of appointments the following day, if that were to happen. And let me see. And then
you have Kim K.
Kim K. I did not call Kim. She applied to be a trustee, but then she withdrew her application. So I felt Christine was more sincere about wanting to serve. Neither one had extensive qualifications, but they had willingness.
Okay.
And she knows it starts tomorrow morning, or what time?
She does. She's already been sent a packet to review.
That was my next question.
Yeah.
Because I know there's also online training, but it's kind of tight for that now.
Yes. So she was given mailed a thick packet to look at on what the responsibilities are, and she's knows that she has a meeting tomorrow if she should get appointed.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Did anyone else have any questions?
I would just like to say that I think you know, Zane is going to do a good job, but it's my opinion that Roger, I think, would have been, well, not my opinion that I think he would have been. I think he was a more qualified candidate, and I think we missed the boat on not you know, making him or appointing him to the Board of Review. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Did anyone else want to make a comment? Did anyone want to make a motion?
I will move that we appoint Christine Zane to the Board of Review beginning March 7 of 17 and ending on December 31st of 18.
Okay. Would someone like to second that?
Second.
Okay. All right. I have a motion by Trustee Marshall, seconded by Trustee Broughton, to appoint Christine Zane to the Board of Review beginning March 7th, 2017 and ending December 31st, 2018. Is there any further discussion on this? Okay, roll call, please.
De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
No.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries. And now we can move on to new business. All right, first up is the passport grant resolution. And this is a resolution supporting a grant to revitalize, I guess, the ball garage at the Sherman Village Park. So, Fred, maybe you want to fill us in on exactly all the things this would provide for.
Yes, the Recreation Passport Grant is the up the ante by $75,000 this year. It's a grant for renovation projects and new development, but they highly pick over new development, the renovation projects. This is a collaboration with the Village of Ortonville, as far as the matching money goes. The Village owns the building, we operate it. You could probably tell it's under very bad conditions as far as the appearance on the outside. The inside is just as bad. So the money's for the $30,000 less the, I think, $1,800 engineering fees is to renovate it, new roof, new facet boards, plumbing, painting, water heater, electrical has to be looked at, some of the environmental things that we're doing for the points are some trash cans out of recycled plastics, along with a picnic table. The countertop will be recycled plastic. The accessible aspects of the building with the countertop will be lowered for wheelchair accessibility. The bathrooms, which is ADA standards as we speak, will be upgraded to more accessible, where it'll be environmental, as far as paperless. There'll be a hand dryer in there. And what's the faucet? Touchless faucets, so the water turns off the way you can leave it on. LED lighting, LED or sensor switches. So when you walk in, it turns on. You walk out, it turns off. The whole building will be done that way, along with LED lighting. And then the typical stuff for storage is new cabinetry and shelving, We don't need to buy any kind of, this is just building. We don't, not supplying any kind of concession stand refrigerators and stuff like that. So everything's just being updated and modern, more modern building. So that's pretty much what we're doing. And in the parking, we have, for points, we got to have an accessible parking. There's no hand, we have a sign down there that says handicap parking. That sign's going to be gone and removed to accessible parking, which we've talked to engineers, Rowe Engineering, who's the village engineers, that the accessible parking would be put right there in front of the ball garage where it links to the current sidewalks. And then for additional points, we'll probably put another one on the back side because there's not much parking there at all. I think I covered it all.
Okay.
It's quite a bit. It's
anybody
quite
have any questions for Fred?
I do.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Fred, I noticed here the total project cost is $30,000. The grant app is for $30,000. If you were to get the whole grant app, then what happens to the $3,750 from both the Village of Ortonville and the Recreation Park Development?
The way that grant process is handled is the township handles the ins and outs of the purchase orders, paying of the contractor. We handle all that money, and then you're allowed to make a draw from the state and say, we've done X amount of money, then they pay you back. The village would just cut us, the township, a check, if that's what you mean.
No, yeah, I understand that up front. I was just kind of curious if the total cost ends up being exactly $30,000, mm-hmm. and the grant is exactly $30,000, then why is the village or the township having to put in any extra money at that point?
Why do they have?
Why would they if the grant matches exactly what the cost is?
I'm not quite understanding.
He's saying that you're doing a grant application for 30, mm-hmm. and that our donation with our park development, recreation park development restricted funds and the village funds are $7,500. So is the cost really $3,750?
A piece, yes.
No. Oh. $37,500, sorry.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. No,
or is the cost is 30, so if you take our $7,500 out of that,
right,
we're only asking for $29,250,
mm-hmm.
but you put in that the application is 30. Even though we're okay. of the 30, we're putting in 7,500, which is 25%, and then 75% is coming from the state. But you
right.
put in your grant that it's a $30,000 grant.
I'm all for it, Fred. I'm just I was curious about the numbers as well.
Right. That it's a $30,000 project, not a grant.
Now, I have talked to two different contractors about where I was at with estimates.
Yeah,
and
that was
they
my concern.
It's right on. I mean, it could be more if you. Depends on who's doing the job, but from what people I've talked to, it's pretty much right on.
In the village meeting, I thought you mentioned that you were going to actually have the township be the contractor, and you were just going to subcontract out ourselves, right?
That's what.
So
we're
not going to have a general contractor.
That's what the engineers suggested, that we be the general contractor, and we do our regular bidding process.
So my question was, are you sure, how much is this grant that you can get total for the Recreation Passport grant this year? What's the total you can get for a grant
The max that you can apply for,
mm-hmm.
is $40,000.
Okay. Are you sure 30 is enough? Because you're listing all this stuff and mm-hmm. bathrooms and hot water heater and a roof and parking. I'm just wanting to see if 30 is truly enough, if you've got enough.
On the grant application, everything's itemized. So
okay.
I made some phone calls,
and you feel comfortable
I actually
with
upped
that.
Them about 10%.
Because everything always comes in higher, typically.
Seems like it, but.
And if we could ask for more, I was just checking.
Yep.
My other thing was why didn't this one need a public hearing versus the other two that did need public hearings today?
This is their standards or guidelines.
Okay.
They don't call for it.
Okay. And has the village approved their portion yet?
Yes, they did.
Okay.
And there's no engineering prints to be designed unless you get the grant, then engineering.
And did you count that into the cost of an engineer?
Yep.
Price.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just checking.
I've already talked to Rowe Engineering about the money's, it's 15%, like typical what they asked for, and they're okay with it.
Yeah, okay. I just want to make sure the 30 was enough and we wouldn't have to come up with more money, because it doesn't seem like it.
We'll make it work.
Is Rowe are they a local firm? Are they based on a?
I think they're out of Davidson or.
They were in Lapeer and in Flint.
Okay.
All right. Are there any other questions? Would anyone like to read the resolution, or are we comfortable with approving the resolution as presented? I saw faces on reading the resolution. All right, would someone like to make a motion to approve the Recreation Passport Grant Program Authorization and Match Resolution as presented?
So moved.
Second.
These resolutions were presented, we did have a Parks and Rec subcommittee meeting when Candy got back from vacation last week. And so these all have the support of the Parks and Rec subcommittee. Okay, I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Broughton, to approve the Recreation Passport Grant Program Authorization and Match as presented. If there's no further discussion, roll call, please.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. So the next item we have is the Michigan Natural Resource Trust Fund grant resolutions. There's two resolutions for the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund. So make sure that your first paragraph includes Michigan Natural Resource Trust Fund and not land and water. So that's how you know you're looking at the right one. First, we're going to look at the local support for DNR MDNRFT grant submission. So basically, this is a resolution stating that the Charter Township of Brandon trustees hereby support submission of a Michigan Natural Resource Trust Fund application to the DNR for the development of the Brandon Township Community Park. Are there any questions on this resolution? And just to give you an overview, last year we submitted two grants. One was to the land and water, one was to the Michigan Department of Natural Resources Trust Fund, and they were for development of the ball fields at the park and parking and a concession stand. So one had the concession stand and half the parking, and that did not get funded, and the other one had the ball fields and half the parking, and that did get funding. So what we're trying to do is get funding for the other half of the parking, basically. Putting in the basketball court and the volleyball courts is less expensive than doing the concession stand building. So what we're doing is we're applying for the exact same project, but to two different funding sources. So if one gets funded, then we won't get funding from the other. So we're only looking to get one of these funded because it's the same project.
So in total, then there'd be 200 parking spots?
Yes.
Okay, because yes. There's already 100 that was
that
approved.
We're getting funded for, right. And if we're going to do the excavation and the work for 100, we should be doing the whole parking lot. Right. It just makes sense.
So these two grants, the difference between them is one's for more money and the other one's not as, because these are different costs on these grants. So that's
no,
where my...
You had replacement ones?
Yeah, I know, but there's so many paid... Are we looking at ones that are the authorization or the resolution first?
We're looking at the authorization first.
Okay.
And this is for the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund. It should look like this. And it says 70,000 here.
Okay, and the ones with 90 are wrong?
Are wrong, yeah.
Okay, so my 90 goes away.
Yep. Anything with
you're giving me names, and I like numbers. So 70 and the 70. Okay. And then there's these other things, too, that are the local. We got local support, and authorizations. So right now we're looking at the authorizations?
We're looking at local support for the DNR, MDNR TF grant submission.
That has to say Land and Water Conservative Fund.
No, this, that says Michigan Natural Resources Trust.
Okay, so this one. Okay, well, that's where my big confusion was the money was different.
Right. And that was pointed out to us before the meeting by Trustee Cordell, so we fixed it.
Oh, okay.
So that's why, that's why you have, that's why you have new sheets and.
I got here at last minute.
And anyways, it is a bit confusing.
Okay, nope, I got it, and I understood what we were doing because I was part of the last grant, so we're adding on.
Okay, so would someone like to make a motion to approve the resolution for local support for DNR MDN RTF grant submission as presented?
So moved.
Okay.
Second. Support.
Okay, is there any further discussion on this resolution?
Is this the same amount we tried for last year, or has the numbers changed, or?
It was $300,000 last year.
Okay, and now it's $140,000, is that gonna be enough to cover everything?
It's a different project though, because last year was for concession stand building.
Right.
This year, we're just going for the half the parking lot and volleyball courts and a basketball.
So we're not gonna try for the concession stand that's badly needed?
We'll do that next year.
Okay. So is this enough, again, like I asked on the last grant, to cover everything cost-wise?
These prices that they're in, on the grant, they're individually marked off, and they've been the prices that our HRC engineers gave us.
Okay, so it's been looked at by an engineer.
Hey, Fred, real fast, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. The ball diamonds, we're building four new ones or two?
Yeah, four.
Four. Having said that, are they, I know like right now the township, we have to pay to use the school's softball or fields, baseball fields and stuff like that. I mean, are these gonna replace us needing to use those facilities, or is this an addition to that?
It should replace it. If we get more teams, our older division, then we still have an issue. But right now, we currently only use one baseball field from the school district. We're replacing that with our own, and we use two of their softball fields sometimes. Most of the time, it's only one, and we're replacing that as well. The exact same size they have.
Okay, so they're going to be complementary to what we have.
Yep.
Dugouts.
Dugouts, everything.
Fencing all around, home run fencing.
Mm-hmm.
All that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Okay. And those fields are going to be finished when?
Good question.
We're shooting for June of 2018, only if the seed is down by August of 2017, no later than mid-September. We have to have a growing season. So hopefully that will happen.
Thank you.
Okay, are there any other questions regarding this resolution? I have a motion by Trustee Marshall, seconded by Trustee Cordella, to approve the resolution for local support for DNR MDN RTF grant submission as presented. There's no further comments. Roll call, please.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell? Is absent with notice. Right. DePalma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall? I'm Thurman.
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. We can move on to the authorization of local unit of government match for the Michigan Natural Resources Trust Fund grant. So this is the same grant that we just talked about, but this one identifies the amount of funding. We're looking for a project cost of $140,000 Our match is $70,000, which is 50%, and then they will provide the other $70,000. Would someone like to make a motion to approve the resolution authorization local unit of government match?
So moved.
As presented.
Support.
Does anyone have any questions or concerns regarding this resolution? I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Marshall, to approve the resolution of authorization local unit of government match as presented. If there's no further questions, roll call, please.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. Next, we move on to item C, the Land and Water Conservation Fund resolutions. So basically, these are the exact same resolutions that we just looked at. However, these are to the Land and Water Conservation Fund. So first, we're going to look at the local support for Land and Water Conservation Fund grant submission. So would someone like to make a motion to approve the resolution of local support for land and water conservation grant submission as presented?
So moved.
Second.
Support. Is there any discussion on this one or questions? Okay, I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Cordella, to approve the resolution of local support for land and water conservation grant submission as presented. If there's no comments, we will go ahead and do a roll call, please.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. Next, we'll move on to the authorization of local unit of government match. And yeah, this is the same as the other grant. It's a $140,000 project with a $70,000 match. Would someone like to make a motion to approve the resolution of authorization local unit of government match as presented?
So moved.
Would someone like to second?
Support.
All right. Are there any questions or concerns regarding this grant application or this resolution? Okay. I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Marshall, to approve the resolution of authorization local unit of government match as presented. And there's doesn't seem to be any further discussion, so roll call, please.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries. Next, we have a budget amendment. So Brandon Township has been awarded a $150,000 grant from the DNR Land and Water Conservation Fund with matching approved cell tower funds of $259,000, totaling a development project of $409,000, and that's for the baseball fields. The funds are to be used for the development of four baseball fields, bioswales, 100 parking spaces. The way they administer grants now is you have to do a lot of preliminary work before they send us the agreement that we enter into, and part of that involved meeting with the engineer. So I have a bill right now of like $450 for engineering costs, but I don't have a line item to subtract that from, and that will be attributed to part of the grant funding. So basically what we're looking for is to fund the line that is in the suggested motion so that as the bills come in, we can pay them.
I'm fine with the suggested motion, and I'm fine moving the money because I'm excited that we got the grant and that we're going forward. I just think in the motion we should put the amount of money that we're moving, because it just says to move GF Tower Park Development. It gives the numbers. We're not saying how much we're moving.
Well, and we're doing that purposely because we want to move the money as we get the bills, because what happens is if we move money this year and say we move $100,000, mm-hmm. and then we don't spend it all, then it has to go to the next year. And as far as record keeping, it gets quite complicated. It's easier if we move the funding and we can watch the money trail as the invoices come in, and it will give us better records. And it.
So how much are you asking to move, though?
It says.
It doesn't say.
An amend in order to pay the project as they are received, so as the invoices are received.
So each time an invoice is received, you're just going to. So this is like a general motion to always move money?
Right. To pay for the grants.
For this.
Yep. We could put a limit on it, limiting it to our matching funds, which is $259,000, not to exceed.
Do we have any idea what the preliminary work is going to cost before we can actually start getting reimbursement from the grant?
I don't think it's going to be a whole lot more than what we spent. We've met with the engineers twice. So
preliminary before we break the shovel on
site? Before we approve the agreement, or at what point?
No, you're talking about, what, $450 already.
Right.
We have to do certain preliminary work before the grant will even be approved. Do we have any idea what that preliminary work will even
say that,
entail or cost?
What was that part of, what was it called that we had to get back or get approval on before we could proceed?
Well, the SIMCOG.
No, it wasn't SIMCOG.
And then we got the environmental study. All that's been, and right now we're just waiting for the contract. Once we get the contract, then we start the bid process, and that's where the engineers come in. There's about $30,000 engineering costs with this project.
Total,
yeah.
Okay.
But there was historical research on the property itself that had to be done.
Part of the environmental study.
But didn't they say that they were going to be sending us the agreement soon?
Yep, that's next. We should expect at any time the agreement.
So we've already.
To Trustee DePalma, would that answer your question then of if we'd have a base number to start with rather than just throwing it all in, would have a certain number for the preliminary work?
Well, if the board decides not to enter into the agreement, then there won't be any more invoices that come to get paid out of this line.
If we decide to not go into what agreement? To do the?
To do the grant, yes.
To do the grant. So we still have to approve to do the grant?
Yes.
When does that come to us?
Well, that's what we were just talking about. We had to do some preliminary work.
Right.
And submit that to the DNR before they issue us the agreement that we enter into to do the grant.
Okay.
And so we need to pay our bills.
Why don't we just move instead of leaving it blank open since you don't know? Why don't we just move what we need right now? And then we can discuss it once we know that it's all been approved.
I would suggest about $20,000 put in there just to, because you're going to have engineering costs hit you big right away.
That's after it's approved.
After the grant's
approved. And I think we're expecting another bill, but it shouldn't be too much for now. But I mean, we're going to have to do this anyways if we do approve it.
I think until it's approved, we should only move what we have to move. Not that I'm not going to approve it, but there's six other people. But I think we should just approve to only move
what we have. We have $18,000 in blueprints that are going to be drawn up before we put it out to the bids, because the contractor's got to have something to bid off.
But that will happen after it's approved by the board.
Yeah, well, we're going to approve it.
Candy, this was Candy's idea, so she needs to speak up on this one.
We did this on another project when we actually bought the property and then started putting in the parking lot and stuff. Rather than moving the money a little at a time, we moved it as the bills came in. So it was sitting over in restricted as the bills came in. The bookkeeper and the treasurer would move the money from the fund over to where it had to go. And they carefully watched that nothing went over budget. And you'll get a report every month. I mean,
can we put something in like Kathy suggested? Just some kind of reasonable limit? Just so
sure.
It's not an open line item?
Sure.
Well,
absolutely.
I think if we haven't approved this to even happen, then we should only move what we need to move then until it's approved to happen.
Didn't we already approve to go for this grant and we got the grant?
That's
now
what
we
I
just
thought,
have to sign the agreement.
But you don't
to
know.
Me, we already agreed to move forward.
I would hope that it would move forward, but
I can't imagine
if
it won't.
We don't,
I can't imagine it won't either.
If we don't agree to the grant, then we're not going to be
moving any money.
Moving money.
Right.
Post that point, but we still have to pay the bills that came in now.
Right, so that's what I was saying, approve that, or, I mean, I was fine moving the whole thing. I don't know how it gets so complicated. You move the whole thing, it's there, then you don't have to have all these movings and movings and movings where it can get mixed up, too.
And I don't know, and you'd know better than I would. What would be easier for the bookkeeping, Dana? Because you're the.
I don't do it in the office here, but I know. I mean, you usually put your whole thing to the budget, and you just start spending away. You don't just move part of it and then move part of it. I think that'd be a lot of more work to keep moving it. I think it'd be easier if you moved the whole amount and just took from it instead of having to keep moving money.
Would you like to make that motion?
For record keeping purposes. It's better to move it as it comes
as the
through.
Bills come in.
It does.
The and bills have to be approved by the department head.
And it's easier to follow what the bookkeeper
nuts.
Is doing.
Whatever makes it easier
okay.
for
whatever
you.
Whatever makes it easier
is,
for you.
Yeah.
This, to pay, I
Candy, if you like to do it that way.
Do it
do
as
it
this
way.
Is presented yeah. and do it as the bills come in.
And we can write not to, like Scott
yeah, right.
suggested,
so
we can say not to exceed $10,000 prior
right.
to
just
prior
some
to. Approval.
Right.
Or something like that. Do you want to add
some
that
some number
on?
That you pick, Candy, because you know, even if it's 20, just so there is some limit
yeah.
on it.
I don't think 20,000 is
okay.
a lot of money. We're talking 400.
Not to exceed $20,000 prior to an approved agreement.
Sure.
Yeah, I
yeah,
guess
Fred
that way
knows
we just don't.
What expenses he's got coming, and
that way we just don't spend a bunch of money before it's approved to do this project.
Right, and if it does go over that, then it'll have to come back to the board, and we'll know about it then at that point.
Yep.
I'm guessing, right?
Yeah. Okay, so what you're saying is the board needs to approve this again once the agreement's approved?
No, I'm just saying that if. No, I'm not. I'm not saying that. Let's put it that way.
Okay. So the way, this, just so we understand this correctly, so the way this is coming out is we're going to approve the funding for the grant, but not to exceed $20,000 prior to the approved agreement. But once the agreement's approved, we are approving the continuation of paying the bills. All right, would you like to make the suggested motion?
I would be happy to make the suggested motion as amended.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to move general fund tower / park development funds to general fund tower - park designated and amend park development LWCF grant accordingly. In order to pay invoices for the LWCF project as they are received, not to exceed $20,000 prior to the approved agreement.
Second.
Okay. Is there any other discussion on this item? Okay, I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Broughton, to move general fund tower park development funds to transfer general fund tower park designated and amend park development LWCF grant accordingly in order to pay invoices for the LWCF project as they are received, not to exceed $20,000 prior to an approved agreement. Okay, everyone's good with that? Okay, roll call, please.
De Palma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. All right. Now we're going to talk about the police liaison contract. So before us, we had a discussion at our last meeting with Lieutenant Glover and Superintendent Matt Outlaw. And the board seemed to be willing to enter into agreement where the township split the cost of the police liaison officer for the school year. So what you have before you reflects that, the contract that's being presented. The other thing that we're looking at is the overtime costs. Now, in here, I put they will pay for overtime costs which exceed 20 hours. In the past, they've kept it under 20 hours, but this last fall, it's already gone over 20 hours. So usually what we do is keep track of overtime hours and then bill separately. I was kind of hoping that I wouldn't have to keep track of it, but it looks like I'm going to have to keep track of it anyways if we put the 20 hours on. But I just wanted to let the board know that that was in there. I don't know how the board feels about that. And what else did I write in here?
Did the school see this contract yet?
Yes.
And they were okay with the overtime and everything in the contract?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, speaking on behalf of Terry, who could not be here tonight, she asked that we not vote on this tonight. She was under the assumption we were all going to have a workshop and was expecting to
have
a workshop on it.
That was my thought, too. Uh-oh. That we were going to have further discussion on this. Because not that I am opposed to it, but I have some questions about it. And, I'm not ready to vote for it. If I am forced to a position of voting for it tonight, I'll vote no. But I have some questions I need to I need to have answered. So I was also under the impression we were going to have a workshop with it to discuss it.
On the liaison officer?
Yeah.
Because that, our discussion was last meeting. The workshop that we're going to have is going to be for ordinances.
Yeah, at our last meeting, we said we were going to bring it back for vote. Is there any way we can maybe answer your questions tonight?
Right, tonight, because we have people here to answer questions.
They're also working on their budget for next year.
Yeah, I understand.
Well, she asked me to bring that up, and I said I would definitely.
Yeah, I think there was probably a misunderstanding because the workshop that we're going to have is for ordinances to discuss those with the Planning Commission, because the Planning Commission really has nothing to do with the police liaison contract.
Right, and part of the questions I have goes to a placement of the staff, and I know the lieutenant addressed it last time about. You know, at one point, the liaison officer was placed in the middle school, and I certainly don't want to overstep our bounds as the board, but and step on your toes as far as placement. But I kind of hate to write out a blank check and have it just the officer can go wherever you want him to without any concern for what we're actually paying them to do.
And by the way, Rich is here. He's our police liaison officer.
And maybe, Rich.
Yes. And maybe Lieutenant Glover would like to introduce him.
I would. First of all, Rich Hubble's the new school liaison, replacing Eric Overall, who is now one of our day shift patrolmen. To answer that question, early on this year, I was very surprised with where the school decided to assign the officer. I was not for that. I've always and still stand strong that the liaison officer, I believe, is best served between the middle school and the high school. With time at the elementary schools when those times are needed. I did have very good discussions with Dr. Outlaw a couple months ago now. He is under the agreement that the school liaison also should be at the high school. And currently, since Deputy Hubble was placed there, his office is now at the high school.
Okay, so is this a verbal agreement? I mean, my biggest question is why is the school board directing where our deputies are going?
Well, because at this point, other than during the summer, the school has funded that position 100%. Other than for when we keep them here when school is out for the summer. So as far as for me to dictate when they're paying for the position 100% to dictate, and even though I didn't agree with it, they're the ones paying the bill, and
so if we have an emergency situation where we have to pull the liaison officer to handle a situation outside of the school can say, no, we don't think so, we're paying for it and we want it here?
No, if there had been an emergency situation, and there has been, to where we have actually used him. There have been a couple high priority calls where we had to have him for body-wise, and that was never an issue.
Well, and if we're paying now 50%, that's what the agreement kind of from the talks I've had with Lieutenant Glover and with Dr. Outlaw was, that we're not going to keep track of time. I'm not going to expect the officer to keep track of, okay, I spent 50% my time this week and 50%, and then this week I spent 70 and 30, and I spent 60 and 40. It's just going to be known, because we don't know what the community is going to do. Hopefully, you know, you don't know what's going to come about. You don't know if the kids right. are going to need them more, or if the community is going to need them more. So it's just going to be known that his office is at the high school, and he's to do high school work and community work, whichever one is top priority. And if he gets pulled by us, the school's to understand, and if he gets pulled to the school for a full day, we're to understand. That was my understanding of what was going to come of it, and we're paying 50% of it, so hopefully we could have kind of a say of, we'd really prefer he's at the high school. I think we've all made that known. And
and from conversations that I've had with Dr. Outlaw, I mean, that's not a question. He understands, they understand that he is needed at the high school. You know, that his position at the intermediate school, I mean, the school liaison officer is not a social worker, he's not a recess monitor, and there is a need for it between the high school and the middle school, mm-hmm. and Dr. Alla understands that's where he's best served. So, I mean, and it is agreement that we've had, but they've been great conversations, and I have no reason to believe that Dr. Outlaw would not adhere to that.
Well, and before, when he got pulled to us, they were paying that bill. We were only paying the summertime and
correct.
Christmas and the Easter or spring break, well, not Easter, but, you know, we were only paying for that time. So there was times he was being pulled to work on township stuff, but they were footing the bill. So that's why they came to us, and that's why I got a better understanding of it, that they've been footing the bill for some of our time. So now they're saying, let's split
Absolutely.
The bill, because when you look at the officer's time spent, it's about 50-50.
Close enough to it.
Yeah, well, that's
yeah,
I
close
said.
Enough
it's
to
close
it.
Enough
I mean, there are
yeah,
times, absolutely, when we need him. I mean, he's when I talked about those CPS referrals. I mean, we're inundated with them, and if the substation detective is tied up on another case, those cases get kicked to the side, and those are cases that we can't afford not to look at. So at times, because it's a juvenile issue or a student of the schools, that has fallen on the school liaison to take care of that job.
And Bob, just so you understand, the school is not able to contract directly with the Oakland County Sheriff's Office for
sure,
the liaison
right.
officer.
Right.
So they have to go through the local municipalities.
Right. No, I get that.
To do that.
Like I said, my concern was that, trust me, I am not anti-law enforcement. that's not my position here. I just want to make sure that we're getting our money's worth.
Well, and the officer's not just a school. I mean, he's a, is he a deputy?
He's a patrol investigator. He's a detective.
He's a detective.
He, right. he oversees his entire cases. And I mean, just this week alone, I mean, we've been nonstop with issues at the high school, and he's been tied up entire days there. So, I mean, it is an issue. But on an occasion, yes, I mean, we do need him for manpower. Those are things that just happen to come up.
Kathy, again, yes. Like Bob, I'm not a no, but I really thought we were going to be able to talk more about this, because
It's a big number. It's, you know, $47,000 or, you know, as costs rise. This is $500,000 over the next 10 years. We haven't discussed at all how we're going to pay for it. There's been no discussion. Where is that money going to come from?
Good question.
Well, I'd like to discuss that, and that's why I think maybe a workshop is a better way to go.
Well, if you look at our police budget, which would be in your reports,
Yep.
It's the thick one, and you go to 207, which is the police budget. The police budget is, the revenue for the police budget comes entirely from tax dollars as far for funding. Through a millage.
It's 207, so it's, if you're looking at pages, it's kind of cut off because of the hole. Keep flipping.
I'll let you do it. That's already 210, so it's just back.
Yeah. 207. So okay. Here's the start of the police.
Page
here's our
41.
Revenue. That's our total revenue. And then
there's 40 something of 41.
Oh, the last something of 41. I got a hole through mine.
Yeah.
We all do.
So by, I mean, the way I looked at it is the school was going to spend the 50 no matter what. They were either going to get a retired cop for 50,000 or they would continue to pay the 50 along with us, and it would be better to have an officer there who knows what's going on in the township and knows what's going on in the school. If it's a retired cop, he's not going to have the access to what the officers have.
That doesn't answer my question of how, where is the money coming from out of the township?
It's going to come from the carry forward in the police budget. So basically, we would have to amend the
Resta 17
contracted, let's see, not the contracted wages, but the liaison wage line item. We have right now budgeted $96,500, both for revenue and expenditure.
Right.
So we would lower that to...
The reimbursement would be lowered up in revenue?
Yeah, to 54, I think, or 52, what is it?
Well, they're going to reimburse...
52,181. Well, actually, it won't be that because the school year is different from our calendar year that we budget on.
So only half of a year is what will change this year, correct?
Correct.
So it's going to be about 25 this year, basically, because it's 50 a year they're asking for, and we're only looking at September through December.
But the fall is less than the spring.
Right, so it's not even that much. I'm just trying to give. So 17, our budget this year, it's only going to change 20. I mean, I could run the numbers, but it's not going to change a whole lot. It's the following year we'd have the whole $50,000 hit, basically.
Where it'll change a difference of 42.
Right. So there's money in our carry forward to do that.
But there was also a big workshop last year that the board held debating the whole carry forward and how much they wanted to have into the fund balance.
Right.
Fund balance is low, and we stuck with the 3.875 mils. And are we going to up the millage to cover this additional cost?
I don't want to have to.
No.
Our fund balance is never going to grow.
It is going to grow. It's just going to grow a little bit slower. And that's where my whole argument was, they were trying to get it to grow faster because what the CPA said, and I'm a CPA, and I just feel that we're not requiring all our funds to grow that fast, so why does the police have to grow that fast? We have the funds. We don't have to grow it.
I'm not saying grow up fast, but it was at 183, and if according to the auditor, it should be at, what Kathy say, 50%. You know, we're not requiring any of ours.
They used to say 25. Now they say 50, and we're not requiring any of them to be at 50. I mean, the fire is not close to 50, so I'm not clear how all of a sudden
we can take another $47,000 bite out of our police budget, and we don't have to make any other changes. You know, I would think we need to address, you know, how are we going to cover this?
Let me understand this.
We've got three new board members that aren't familiar with budgeting, so I can understand the reservations.
So right now we have budgeted for the liaison position $96,500.
Correct.
Correct?
Yes.
That number will be reduced down to what?
To be divided evenly by the 10 months, or how does that work?
Can we put on the 52?
It's five.
Dana, on the contract, the first half of the year is 21,243.
21,243, the first half meaning September to December?
Yes.
Okay, so it's 21,243, so they want us to cover half of that?
Well, that's what we would be covering now.
Now.
So what were we covering before? I don't have that contract in front of me. Was it like 38?
I see what it is, okay. I don't know, we'd have to, do you wanna get it?
That kind of.
Is it on here?
No, because that's the whole year, that's 96.5.
Yeah, the whole year.
Well, just give me a ballpark, what we're looking at for the whole year.
Say 40, so the difference between 40 and 20.
It's like 20.
20 for this budget, for the 2017.
Okay.
For the budgeted year of 2017.
Our ending balance would be another 20 lower.
So 76,500.
Would be our reimbursement this year?
Right, it's 96,500right now.
96,500.
So if we save 20,000.
This one doesn't have.
Plus 21,244, maybe, yeah, like 75 to 80, that's what I said, it's gonna be like a $20,000 difference for this budget. And that's what I said, yes, our CPA firm said we should have a fund balance of 50. I don't wanna raise taxes to do this, but I feel it's important for our residents for us to do this, because if they go and get, the school district's gonna spend the money anyways.
Well, that was the one thing that struck me last meeting with some of the public comments. And I had talked to Scott about this, and the comment that struck me, I mean, I'm looking at it as a township. And I'm not looking at it as a township resident. And a couple township residents said, you know, it doesn't matter to me if it comes out of my right pocket or my left pocket. I'm still paying for it.
Correct.
Either way, so looking in the big picture, I'm not opposed to it.
Because that's the thing, go ahead, sorry.
Because the residents themselves want it. And they're saying, hey, I'm gonna pay for it one way or the other. I just wanna see what kind of savings we're getting out of it and make sure that we're getting what we're actually paying for.
Well, and that's why I sat down and asked about the time, and it is, the time is so close that we are getting the money for it. And if we didn't do it, they were gonna spend the 50 anyways, and then if we needed to hire another cop, the township's actually gonna spend more money because we won't have the overtime savings of the 11. The township's still gonna be spending 50 through the school, and then we're gonna need to keep that officer on to cover that workload that they've already been doing. So then we're paying for a whole nother officer. So I think in the end, like they said, is it coming out of my pocket to the school tax, or is it coming out of my pocket to the township tax?
And that was a selling point for me when the residents point, you know, put it in that way.
Right, it's gonna save the township money still by continuing to do it like this. And yes, I will admit we're not gonna grow our budget as fast, but we're still, our carry forward, we're still going in a positive nature even without raising the millage, because I don't want to raise the millage either. But we're still gonna be growing it, it's just gonna take another year maybe, or 2 years.
So if you look at our 2017 budget, mm-hmm. we're looking at a carry forward of $317,318, which is on the next page.
Next page.
This one right here.
Okay, great.
So that would end up changing to closer to 300,000.
Correct.
So okay. All right.
Is where the funding is going to come from.
All right, gentleman's agreement then.
It is.
So gentleman's agreement.
Absolutely.
You are going to be directing the placement of the officer and the time, hours worked, that kind of thing. It's not going to be. We're not going to acquiesce to Dr. Outlaw, the supervisory role of a police lieutenant?
No, absolutely. Okay. I mean, it is a gentleman's agreement. I mean, we've talked about it. We've had some lengthy discussions. It's working very well right now. Now I was definitely not for him being at the intermediate school. I thought that was a waste of police services personally. But they were paying for the position, so it was difficult for me to argue it, even though I didn't agree with it.
So that's where I get concerned.
Yes.
Because you were concerned about it before.
Yes, but
and nothing happened. This is why I want to make sure that you're in charge.
Nothing happened because I didn't have a leg to stand on. I didn't have a leg in a fight for the most part.
But now this is going to help you.
Absolutely.
It's all about helping you, LT.
Absolutely. Well, I can tell you that without having that position at the high school, we would still have to respond to those calls. I don't care how many security guards they have.
Sure.
They have no law enforcement powers. And we would still have to respond to all those calls and deal with those investigations. And I can tell you right now that there is no way that one detective in the substation would be able to handle that caseload, that additional caseload. it would be impossible for us.
Okay, but so you are remaining supervisor of the desk.
Bob, I don't know if they can commit to having one person supervisor over the other, but the position is a deputy for the Oakland County Sheriff's Office. So
right.
In that regard, he is their supervisor.
I understand
when he's in the school has say as far as, and maybe Dr. Outlaw can speak to exactly how you determine where the school lays on.
And that's the part.
And maybe you can explain how the caseload occurs for the school.
And that's where I have a problem, though. That's what I'm addressing.
Yes.
I want the lieutenant to be in charge of his troops.
I can tell you, I mean, believe me, I'm in charge of my troops.
There is no question about that.
I dictate how police work is done in my substation and amongst my guys. But I have never had an issue with Dr. Outlaw on how to police that building. We had a case of a possible active shooter there a couple years ago, and I made it very clear that when it becomes police work, I will do the police work, and nobody else is going to dictate how we handle a police situation in that school. And that's the way that it's always been. Dr. Outlaw understands that, the same as I don't tell him how to run his schools. We've had a great working relationship.
Okay.
No issues there whatsoever.
All right.
And he's going to continue to spend his time based on what is needed by the community of where his time's spent.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah.
And so maybe you could give us an idea, Dr. Outlaw, of how...
First off, just on the location, high school is the place where the police liaison belongs. We experimented. We tried a different building to see if we could get him into more buildings because he serves the whole district, not just the high school. It was a failed experiment. We're back at the high school. That's where he's going to remain. It really is a partnership. It's police liaison position. We work really well together. Detective Hubble's been a great addition. We've already been working together on all kinds of things. We're very much on the same page. We've had conversations with Detective Hubble coming on board about how we want him to be more of a police officer. We want more police presence, a police feel in that building. And he's been doing a great job for us. But at the end of the day, he serves both of us, but our purposes are the same. We have a police liaison not to be a hall monitor or a social worker. We have him here to be a police officer. And the kids are township residents, and some of them are Groveland Township and other spots, but they're residents as well. So we're very much on the same page. If Lieutenant Glover doesn't like something, he comes in and talks to me. If I'm not liking something, I come over, we sit down, and we hash it out. We have a great working relationship. We've had a chance to work together for a couple years now, and I see that continuing into the future.
I just have a question. Are you still having security guards at the high school? Or you don't have security guards at the high school?
The security guards were there for a separate reason. They were there because of a fire alarm system that will be corrected, hopefully, by the end of the day tomorrow. So
then
they were doing fire watch things.
So then they will be gone then?
They will be gone,
right.
Yes.
Okay, so it will just be
correct.
Detective Hubble.
You know what, I guess we're going to end up hashing this out tonight. I do have a couple more questions. What do you consider, what was the peak year for enrollment in the high school, just the high school? Just general numbers.
Okay. High school, the peak enrollment was about 1,200.
And what year was that, just so I know?
About 2005-06.
Okay.
That was kind of the
and
peak
so
for the
district.
And so
now we're at?
Now we're at 977.
Okay. So we're not half as small, but it's, you know, roughly X percent.
Correct.
And for the lieutenant then, how have we seen from max enrollment to where we are now the amount of involvement that the liaison officer has been involved? In other words, has the drop in enrollment decreased the need for what you guys do?
Unfortunately, with the decreased enrollment, you would hope that it would have the opposite effect and we would have less contact.
Right.
But it's actually probably been the opposite. I think we've actually become more busy with a certain aspect of those students than we were before. I can tell you that since I've been here, that school liaison position has changed drastically from what was there prior to my arrival and when I arrived. When I was assigned to Brandon, one of the first things that I did was remove the current school liaison that was in there. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel like, the department didn't feel like the job was being done the way that it should have been. And just as an example, prior to Deputy Overall's arrival, that school liaison officer wrote one report for the entire school year. Deputy Overall, his first year, wrote, or had actually over 100 different cases that he was involved in, and wrote 38 investigations. So that gives you an idea of what, how the job was being done. Now, discussions that I've had with Dr. Outlaw, and they have been very positive discussions on how he feels that that job needs to be done in the school. And it is that of a police officer. It is targeting drug dealers, targeting problem kids, to where they don't affect the rest of the school system. And that is exactly what we've been doing since Detective Hubble has come into the school. So it's not a something where the school's closing their eyes to it. I mean, there is police work to be done there, and it is being done now.
Okay.
But I can tell you that those numbers have not went down for us. They've actually been on the increase.
That was my second stumbling block.
Absolutely.
Here tonight, and I guess if that answers a big question.
It
for
does.
Me.
It has been on the increase for sure, and part of that is because of the narcotics issues. Mm-hmm. You know, the medical marijuana absolutely flooded the school systems with. Because those kids now will justify in 10 different ways of why marijuana is good for you. Mm-hmm. And it goes from, and they don't call it the gateway drug for nothing, it goes from medical marijuana to stronger things. And that's the issues that we face with the kids now.
Did you see any drop? I want to be careful how I word this. Did we see any drop in issues that you have to address once we quit providing transportation from other communities for school of choice?
Well, that's a difficult question. I can tell you that the school of choice kids are not they're not a major problem for us. Absolutely, we do have contacts with them. It's usually the families and friends that come into the community along with those students.
Okay.
I wouldn't say that the school of choice kids are our problem.
Not in general, but I just meant from the, because I know for a while we were providing transportation as well. Correct. Right.
I have not seen a lot of issues with that.
Okay.
As far as transportation part of it, no.
Okay.
I'm
all set.
You're all set, Bob?
I'm set. I'm a happy camper.
Okay.
And Kathy, this can also be, we can revisit this again next year. This is a one-year contract. Okay.
The contract's written for next school year.
Right.
So for
it's actually through June of 18.
Sure. But we would revisit it if we were going to around this time.
Next year.
Yes. I mean, I know the security guard thing has been a big issue. And to tell you, I mean, I was over in Rochester Hills for a short time and dealing with other substations. We have other school districts that have security guards in them. And most of them are retired officers. But anytime something becomes a police issue, we get called there anyways to deal with it. And I mean, the security guard, the schools that have went to security guards, and I'll use Oxford as an example, has went back to a school liaison because the security, those kids know how much power, how much authority a security guard has.
Yes, but
they figure it out in short order.
On the other hand, and you know, I don't want to cause issues here, but there, since the school liaison officer is required in court, whatever else he has to do off-site, there are blocks of time where there's no security at the high school. That was my third problem with how this is set up. But I'm going to trust your judgment on that.
That does happen on occasion, but I'll tell you, I mean, we cover it. My guys know that if Deputy Hubble's in court or he's at a CPS right. hearing, that the guys have their ears on, they know. Usually even my guys respond irregardless if something jumps up. You know, rarely do we allow for something that's serious for one guy to be there. I mean, Dr. Outlaw can attest, a lot of times when Deputy Hubble just recently has had events there, I usually arrive myself. So, I mean, we always have the coverage for it.
Okay.
As far as manpower-wise.
Thank you very much. Okay, does anyone have any questions on the contract itself as far as the costs? No? All right. Yeah, you're all good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Also,
we wanted to add in here a discussion of, since we are going above what we did last year as far as helping the school district out, one of the trustees, and I think Chris wants to expand on this a little further, was wondering if maybe the school district would be in a position to help us out a little bit more with our recreation costs for our recreation programs.
Do I speak to the board, or do I speak to Dr. Outlaw, or?
Well, just, you can speak to the board and include Dr. Outlaw.
Dr. Outlaw, is, me and you met at a meeting, and I said, like, yeah, I think this is going to happen, and it appears that it is going to happen, that we are going to pick up the 50%, you know. But I said, you know, there's probably going to be a caveat to that, and the caveat to that is simply that I feel, I don't know the way the rest of the board feels, but I don't see the need for us to pay you guys to use athletic facilities like we do today, not only just to use them, but also pay a maintenance fee for them. I totally believe that as all the township residents own those schools, those buildings, those athletic facilities, you've got the manpower. You know, especially when it comes to the gyms, you need to clean them once a day, no matter what. So the costs for cleaning and stuff like that are covered already. And the ballpark issue, I've already talked with Fred, and Fred answered it. But what I'm asking is basically to drop, let's drop this if we could, you know, this charge system for us using facilities when we need to, athletic facilities in particular. In other words, you know, it is a really big problem, you know, and we've lost one heck of a man in Steve Bernal, I believe his last name was. And the bottom line is that poor man, and I worked with him for about 3 months, you know, he's got to load up, he's got to hook up the trailer, he's got to load the trailer up with you know, a lawn garden mower, and he's got to bring the chalker with him, the chalk machine, he's got to load up all kinds of rakes, shovels, whatever, do his job. He's got to bring bases in a lot of cases because the base boxes are closed. And what I'm asking is that your guys do it like they normally would do it after any school event, after any school ball game. Does that sound like
Sure, if you want to step up and answer, we're
a fair gesture, being that we're kind of reaching out to you guys to, you know, accommodate, you know, and you know, it's a generous offer that we're making.
No, absolutely. And
I didn't think we'd even go all that way, but go ahead.
No, I appreciate the dialogue very much. One thing I'm going to throw out is I'm a servant of a board of education, and there are 7 people that are elected by the township to represent the school district. So I'd be happy to take that idea back to our board, share it with them. I'm not a policy maker. I'm their agent. So I think engaging in a dialogue on that, I would say that we're definitely interested in having a conversation. But I can't commit to what the Board of Education would want on that topic. So I know that sounds like I don't mean to be a cop-out on that, but Board of Education president
what do you think
is here.
I mean, just off the top of your head, and Kevin, you're here. What do you think the board would say to something like that?
You know, I'm not. This isn't a topic we haven't talked about, so I'm not going to guess at that. Unless I would want to have a chance to talk. So,
how do you feel, Kevin?
How do I feel?
Yeah.
Personally. About,
yeah.
Personally, I would say.
Well, no, not personally.
Kevin,
as a board
stand
member.
Stand up to
sure.
The
park.
As a member of the board, with what we just or what I just discussed, how do you?
Well, again, for me. Personally, I think there's certainly merit in discussing what you're saying. But again, I'm no different. You know, even though I'm the president of the Board of Education, it's a board of 7 people. So if 4 people don't agree with me, it doesn't fly. So you know, being that this is the first time it's been brought up, I have not discussed this with any other board members. You know, I'm not going to say, you know, the Board of Education says X, because I don't know the answer to that. Again, like Dr. Outlaw, I'll take it to my fellow board members and run up the flagpole. I have no problem with that. Again, I see where you're coming from. I understand the position, and we'll go from there. Just the same thing as here tonight. You guys obviously have had a great deal of conversation about a topic amongst the seven of you, well, six. So it would be the same thing with my board, right? And I certainly owe them that opportunity to chime in. Best I can say right now.
We haven't had that conversation. This is the first I heard of that, just to let you
know.
It's all of us, though.
I just brought it up, and we just
wanted
to move on to Florida.
Yeah, it's the first of us.
At one time, I know that BGO did not pay school fees and such, and I always questioned that. Why shouldn't we help pay the heats, the light, your maintenance
wear and
people
tear.
And such?
Yeah.
And that also is why we have program fees for kids to be involved in basketball, whatever.
One of the big issues comes into overtime, really.
Right, the janitors.
Because a lot of times the events are held, you know, after and outside of school hours. Yep. And especially if you're looking at custodians, you know, we've outsourced that service. So whenever they're outside of their normal schedule, or if they bring additional people in to clean up after events, you know, we pay for that. So that was a lot of what came out of that, too, when, you know, we restructured that. Now, some of the different things, you know, outdoor ball field, that's a different situation because we handle maintenance pretty much ourselves as far as, you know, the grounds. So that's probably a little more of a transparent cost. But certainly if you look at, you know, internal building things, and mostly it's the custodial type services, those are real direct costs when there's other events that happen.
Is the tier system still in place, Brad, do you know, with the school?
No.
Because it used to be the school was the top.
It is in place.
Yeah, it is.
Is it? Okay.
It
and
is.
Then recreation was, and then the major public.
Yes.
So we're actually paying less.
Right.
50% less, yeah.
Than
well,
what?
I thought he was referring to, we used to be sponsored by the school where we paid nothing.
Oh, no, I meant the tier system from the school as far as charging for facilities.
Right. Yeah, so we already get a discount.
Yep. We're paying half of what,
right?
Yeah, if another organization, so to speak, of the general public were to come in,
but you guys
would pay half of what they would pay.
Yeah.
Right. But we used to use the facilities for free at one point.
Yeah,
and I can tell you as a 14U travel coach with my team, and I've used that high school facility as well as HT Burt for quite a long time, probably 10 years, and we have always paid a fee to that. Now, I don't know what the fee is as opposed to what the rec department does, but we've always paid a fee.
50% more.
Probably.
Yes.
So we have been getting a discount already.
Yeah.
So
okay.
I mean,
I can't speak exactly where their group falls on the tier, but the tier, or you know, that arrangement is still in place.
Okay. I was hoping.
Everybody's being honest here. Let me.
We're always honest.
Parks and Recreation uses school facilities. We can't survive without them for our indoor sports. And we, of course, we use the varsity softball, JV softball, JV baseball. We used to get charged $27 an hour or something like that. They have majorly reduced it to $10 an hour. But when it comes to baseball fields, it's not, that's the only one we're not really even Stevens with. Travel gets, I've noticed, get a little bit more priority than what we do. They got more teams. But generally, we use the school facilities about 400 plus hours a year. So we pay the school district around $4,000 a year.
That's not much.
For the schools.
That's not much.
Not a lot of money.
Not much, but you got to remember, we're self-supported.
Right.
So program money has to pay for that stuff.
Right, but usually you count that into the program fee. So,
yes.
I mean, I don't want to see this hold up our vote. I'm ready to make a motion.
Yeah,
I don't think
we're sort of getting off on a tangent here.
Well,
yeah, and I just would like you guys to take it back and present it to the board. And I think it's a reasonable request. You know, and I think it's something worth looking at. If you guys can.
But it's.
I don't think you need to. My own.
I was just
going to
say it's not from the whole board request. You know, I mean it's.
No, it's not. But it is something that I think is going to become, well, especially this year, with the new person that you have to hire, Fred, and that person having to do the work that Steve did. You know, like I said, a yeoman's job It's going to be really hard for them to do the baseball fields especially. So if we could, like, you know, I mean, if you get, when you guys present it to the board, if you guys could just, like, you know, get an agreement from the board that, you know, we will handle the baseball facilities because you already have people there.
Can we call the question?
I'll make a motion.
Yes.
Motion to approve the intergovernmental agreement to provide a police liaison officer for the Brandon schools during the period of time between September 5th, 2017 and June 15th, 2018 as presented.
Second.
And you seconded, Bob? Okay. I think we had a good discussion on this. We certainly answered a lot of questions. So we have a motion by Trustee DePalma, seconded by Trustee Marshall, to approve the intergovernmental agreement to provide a police liaison officer for Brandon schools during the period of time between September 5th, 2017 and June 15th, 2018 as presented. Is there any further discussion? Okay, roll call please.
Cordella.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Allen.
Yes.
Broughton.
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. DePalma.
Yes.
Thurman.
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. And I wouldn't mind getting cut a break on anything, really. That's my personal opinion. All right, thank you.
What you do.
All right, next, we're going to do the second reading of the ordinance change. Good night. So this was presented to the board at our last meeting, and it is to adopt for second reading an ordinance by amending Chapter 46, Article 4, Section 46-2421C to read, detached accessory buildings or structures shall not be erected in any residential front yard except as follows. One, for farms and farming operations is outlined in subsection 3 of the section, and two, where lots are abutting navigable lakes and canals. Would someone like to make that motion?
So moved.
Support.
Is there any discussion on this?
I just have a question, just in curiosity, and it just struck me. Mm-hmm. Because last time the building inspector was here, he said we don't have a farm or agricultural zone. We have a rural estate.
Rural estates.
Then how do we justify farms and farming operations?
Farms, well, it's outlined in subsection 3 of the section, and I don't happen to have it with me here.
I'm just sort of curious.
I know that for residential R1E, farming is a use of the land.
Okay, so it's not a zone, it's a use.
A use.
And the use is determined by that section? I'm just curious. It's just like if we don't have an agricultural area, how do we have farming?
Farming is allowed in our R1E.
Okay, that was it. Wasn't going to cause problems.
Any other questions? All right, seeing none, the motion is being presented by Trustee DePalma and seconded by Clerk Allen. And if there's no discussion, roll call, please.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. DePalma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. Our next.
Supervisor Thurman, I had a question how the motion should read. To approve the.
It's right on here.
And behold. Wasn't right at the bottom, so of course I didn't see it. I apologize.
No problem. We didn't have enough writing above it, so it wasn't at the bottom.
I know.
Like, the next one's the same thing. It's in the middle of the page.
They fooled
just to let you know.
Not like I didn't write them for the Planning Commission to begin with.
Okay, so next we have a second reading for an ordinance change for accessory structures. And that is section 46-242-1D5. Would someone like to make the suggested motion?
I'll make it.
As presented?
As presented, as long as I don't have to read it.
Okay. Do you want to read it? Support.
Is there any discussion on this one? All right, I have a motion by Trustee DePalma, seconded by Trustee Marshall, to adopt for second reading of an ordinance by amending Chapter 46, Article 4, Section 46-2421D5 to read, the total area of all attached accessory buildings in the RE district shall not exceed the total square footage of the living area of the principal building or a maximum of 1,200 square feet. The total area of all detached accessory buildings in the RE district shall not exceed the total square footage of the living area of the principal building less the existing attached accessory building or 1,200 square feet, whichever is greater. The square footage of finished or unfinished basements shall not be considered when determining accessory building area. The area of detached accessory buildings may be increased by 400 square feet for each acre over 2.5 acres where additional acreage is part of a single lot or parcel. Okay. Any discussion or concerns? Roll call, please.
Allen?
Yes.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. DePalma?
Yes.
Cordella?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. And now we are on our last item of business, the new hire for janitorial. Carrie Watts has been working as a temporary employee for the past 3 weeks. She's been doing a great job for us. She works at cleaning this office building and also the senior center. She met with Wendy last week over at the police substation, and it's my understanding that Wendy's going to continue cleaning there, but Carrie will be there to fill in for her when she needs to take time off. And so I'm suggesting that we hire Carrie Watts as part-time janitor for the township offices at Naburton Senior Center and Police Station beginning March 7th, 2017 at the rate of $12.48 an hour.
I'll make that motion.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Second.
Okay, is there any discussion?
So 13 applied, and then an additional 3, or of the 13, 3 were interviewed?
Okay,
I was just confused because I know we usually have a deadline to apply.
Let me see what I wrote here. 13 applications received. Mm-hmm. And what happened was Wendy was ill. So the first week I only had one applicant. So we hired him temporarily to fill in to help Wendy out. Mm-hmm. So he was interviewed by himself. And he was hired with the understanding that we were still taking applications and searching for a replacement for Wendy. So, in looking at their applications and some follow-up calls for availability, 3 additional applicants to that person was interviewed by the clerk, treasurer, and supervisor.
Okay, so it's 3 of the 13. We didn't take 3.
So actually, it's actually 4 applicants were
interviewed out of the total. It's not total 13. Just reading it, I thought we took 13, it was and then we took another 3, and I'm like, well, but if it's past the cutoff of when they can apply?
No, they all had their applications in within the due date.
Okay.
It was just hard to explain in a couple sentences what I just told you.
Okay. So I was just checking. I just wanted to make sure that we stuck to the parameters of how we interviewed. So, okay.
Is there any other discussion?
Is her name K-E-R-R-I or K-E-R-I?
I know it's on there two different ways.
Yeah, it's spelled two different ways. I just want to make sure we have it right for our records.
We have it right in our office.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
She filled out her application and her.
I think it's two R's, but don't hold me to it.
Okay.
Okay. Her check will be written properly.
That's all she cares about.
And who's still cleaning at the place then?
Wendy Harden.
So Wendy just couldn't do it all, so she's staying cleaning at the police.
Yes. She was having some medical
issues.
That's
okay, I don't need to know. And then Carrie is going to do us, and then who's doing the senior center?
Carrie.
Okay, so she'll be here in senior center and then help out at the police when needed. Okay. And if everybody's happy at all the places, then I'm happy.
All right. Any other questions? All right, I have a motion by Clerk Allen, seconded by Trustee Broughton, to hire Carrie Watts as part-time janitor for the township offices at Naburton Senior Center and Police Substation beginning March 7th, 2017 at the rate of $12.48 an hour. And since there's no further discussion, roll call please.
Broughton?
Yes.
Darnell is absent with notice. De Palma?
Yes.
Cordello?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Allen?
Yes.
Thurman?
Yes. Motion carries unanimously. That concludes our new business. At this time, we will take comments from citizens on anything you'd like to talk about. And Heath is jumping up to the microphone. Good job.
I just wanted to thank you for considering doing the Seymour Lake bike trail. So I got the little paper in the mail the other day ago. So me and my wife are very excited that you're considering that as an option. Because
okay.
We have two little monsters at home, and for them to be able to walk to Cook's Dairy Farm to get an ice cream, it means a lot to us. So, no, it's dangerous. It's a dangerous road to walk
on.
Oh,
yeah.
No, I understand. I'm just laughing because getting to Cook's Dairy is always a good thing.
Yeah. It'd be good for the business, too. So, but, yeah. So,
all
thank
right.
you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, Patty Salter, 178 High Banks Trail. Hello, board. Good evening. And Scott, welcome. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I just wanted to voice my displeasure on the ordinance that you just approved about the detached accessory buildings or structures shall not be erected in any residential front yard. I don't think it's really fair to all the residents.
That's not what we did.
To adopt an ordinance, detached accessory buildings or structures shall not be erected in any residential front yard except for, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I don't think that's fair to all of the residents. For example, I have an over acre front lawn. My front lawn is bigger than my back lawn. I'm on a private road and I don't see how this would be relevant to me. So if I was going to put in, or I had an idea to put in a structure, I guess I would have to go and look at your subsection to see about farm and farming operations, because then I would look at maybe farming chickens or getting a couple alpacas. I just don't think that this is fairly written for all the residents. I could see it like in downtown Ortonville, your front, you know, but when you have a huge front lawn, it just doesn't seem fair. So I just wanted to voice that. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would like to make a comment? Okay. All right. At this time, we have some time for board comments. Are there any comments from the board members?
Wasn't the one that we just passed, though, it was never allowed in the front yard, so we were actually
right.
adding to it to allow a few places to be allowed in the
yes.
front yard.
For people
yes.
with waterfront.
For people
and
with, right. So
my suggestion,
it is helping some.
Right. And my suggestion is a phone call to the building department for further clarification on that might be in order.
Right.
But yeah, we were making it a little bit more lenient than what it already is.
And actually, at the last meeting, I did bring up and ask to make, suggested that not just for instances where the backyard, because it says like lakes and canals, and I said, well, what if you had wetlands? I mean, I was trying to make it a little bit more based on homes that are set up where the house is in the back and you have all this front land, but this is the way it was for now. So it became a little bit more lenient. I'd like to see it a little bit more lenient too. Right. Right. Right.
Okay. All right. I also wanted to let the board know that if you ever have anybody that approaches you that is interested in participating on the Planning Commission, the ZBA, Board of Review, or anything, please send them to my office so I can have them fill out an application and I can keep that on file, because I do go back into my file to see who I have interested in those particular spots. And yeah, I didn't advertise for Board of Review because I felt we had 11 candidates that wanted to help the township, and I thought we could, since we had those people volunteering their help, we could find a Board of Review member. And Board of Review is not a real good job if you want a lot of
warm fuzzies.
Warm fuzzies, exactly.
Well, and when I talked to Kathy about Board of Review, I also mentioned it would be good if that in the past we've never put anything in the paper, like when a Planning Commission, when you know the seats are up, to try to advertise, and then also to let us know, because I might know of people at that time and can ask. So I requested Kathy when we talked about this to now on try to give us a heads up as being board members.
How many people are on the schedule for tomorrow?
No, tomorrow is a meeting just for the Board of Review members.
How many people are on the schedule for the first day that the Board of Review meets?
I don't know. I don't think there's too many.
I'm just wondering, is it usually for Brandon Township, is it 5 or is it 50 or?
Oh, it's 3.
Okay.
Is there?
No, there's 3 members on the Board of Review.
Right, no, I was
talking
about
how many
people.
They're having a meeting tomorrow, but you're talking about March 15th
and
16th?
Yes.
We're still taking applications, but generally speaking, we do one every 10 minutes, so that's 6 an hour and about 8 hours a day.
Okay.
Okay. Are there any other comments by the board? Would someone like to make a motion to adjourn?
So moved. Candy beat me.
I beat her.
I'll let you
Who would like to second?
I'll second her, though.
Thank you, Dana.
You're welcome, Candy.
Okay. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Meeting's adjourned.